Back to Advancing Change, the Future of Museum Leadership. Hello, my name is Victoria McCraven, and I'm the current Romare Bearden Fellow at the St. Louis Art Museum. This afternoon, I'll be your moderator, and it was just wonderful seeing the video and the overview of the fellowship for its 30 years, honoring artist Romare Bearden. We had the amazing morning sessions with conversations with arts leaders and an overview of the case study. This afternoon, we will speak with 12 of the 27 Bearden Fellows, and we'll be beginning with Advancing Change in Museum Education and Programming. We have a wonderful group of fellows with us today who are going to speak about their experience in education and programming working at museums across the country. And if you have any questions, please post in the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen, and we'll get to that at the end of the session. So let's get started. Welcome, panelists. Welcome. So I would like you to start by introducing yourselves, giving your current position and institution, where you're physically calling in from. And if you can you reflect on one critical experience or highlight that you've had from the year as a fellow in shaping the career, and you're shaping your career that most benefited or prepared you? Could we start with Jordia?
Hello, so great to be here today. So I'm Jordia Benjamin. I am the Mirken Senior Coordinator of Programs and Audience Engagement at the Colby College Museum of Art in Waterville, Maine, which is also situated on the homeland of the Wabanaki people. So your first question about the lasting impression of the fellowship or the highlight is kind of several fold for me. Today we're here to speak about diversity and hosting a whole summit around it. And so a lasting impression for me is that the museum as a whole, the St. Louis Art Museum, fully understood the importance of this fellowship from the leadership, from Brent, who was always accessible during my time, and I assume for others, right down to the security staff and to the folks that worked in the cafe, and everyone in between. Everyone was embraced me, they embraced the fellows, understood the importance again of it, and I instantly became a member of the St. Louis Art Museum family. It also provided another outlet and a reassurance that I was surrounded by folks every day that not only wanted to see the success or see me succeed within the fellowship, but also wanted to see me thrive outside of it. And the video that we're playing before we came on just spoke to the testament of how really much engagement and heartfelt, genuine care about the fellowship leadership from all levels, from the board, right down to the interworkings of the staff, feel about the fellows and our success and our life after the fellowship. And so that us being here today is a testament of that, of how much they value us, of how much they care about the success. And I also want to say I'm so grateful to be here among other colleagues, especially Sherri, who was also a staff member at the St. Louis Art Museum during my time, a prior fellow who was able to give me such valuable insight to the success of my fellowship. And staff former fellow who was also in the virtual audience, Jennifer, who was during my time as a fellow, was able to give me great insight as well. And so to be mentored by two fellows consistently day by day, and also to have the leadership by Renee, who I know spoke earlier this morning, to be walking with them every day just only strengthened my understanding of the fellowship and how I approach my work currently, learning how to integrate community, learning the importance of voices being heard, being seen at different levels is how I approach my work today. So thank you. Look forward to being more in conversation with you all.
Thank you, Jordia. Could we have Tim? Could you share next?
Sure. My name is Timothy Brown, and I'm currently an educator at the Community College Preparatory Academy here in DC. Prior to this position, I've worked as a museum education and curator over a 20-year period. As a Bearden Fellow, one thing that shaped my career was the opportunity to teach in the arts in a basic curriculum program that was at the San Luis Art Museum at the time. After the fellowship, I was awarded a position titled Curator of Education, K through 12, at a brand new museum. So the fellowship and the experience that I gained from working in the arts and the basic curriculum program really had a direct bearing on what I was able to accomplish in my new position.
Thank you, Tim. Thanks for sharing. It's just wonderful hearing all of you speak about your experiences now, as I'm a fellow and I want to see what could happen in the future for me. Nenette, could you share next your journey?
Hi, everyone. Good to see you all. My name is Nenette Luarca-Shoaf. I am currently the Managing Director of Learning and Engagement at the Lucas Museum of Narrative Art. I'm calling in from Los Angeles, the traditional homelands of the Tongva people. And I want to echo Jordia's reflections about the kind of care that I felt when I was at the museum, and this is now 20 years ago. But I think that that care has extended over these decades because I had been invited back to do work and contribute at different points in my career as a curator, as an educator. Tim and I worked at a summer program at the St. Louis Arts Alliance many years ago together, coming back for symposia. I felt like there was just a continuous network and expectation and support with this fellowship. And it, you know, I had it as many of us do very early in my career. And a really crucial part was this balance between contributing to existing programs and then having the freedom and the agency to chart my own path. I knew there were big expectations of me, in part because of the major contributions and excellent work that the fellows before me had done at the museum. So I knew I was standing on their shoulders. And so I wanted to, and so there were expectations, and I was given great responsibility, or I felt like I was, especially early in my career. And so that's something that I carried with me in subsequent roles and in work with emerging professionals, interns, fellows, graduate students, that I tried to construct experiences that made space for their questions, their approaches, their interests, because I think that the ways that the Bearden Fellowship has changed the St. Louis Art Museum is a testament to the ways that the museum field can be changed by allowing for diverse perspectives and new questions to actually have impact, rather than keeping them siloed within one department or one project.
Thank you, Nenette. And you guys are those expectations for fellows that are coming in now. And it's just amazing to see the work that you're doing. Sherri, could you please share?
Hi, everyone. So happy to be here. I'm Sherri Williams. I'm currently the Manager of Community Programs at the National Gallery of Art in DC. So Tim and I are neighbors. I'm calling from Silver Spring, Maryland. And I would say probably the experience that had the greatest impact on me was actually working with and learning from Renee Franklin. When I was the Bearden Fellow, Renee was the Director of Community Programs, and seeing how she worked and seeing how she considered community and also thought about diversity, equity, access, and inclusion long before it became kind of the trend in museums, has really influenced how I think about audiences and communities, and has actually given direction to my career. When I came as a Bearden, I had no clue, absolutely no clue at all what I wanted to do. My background is not in art history. And so having that year to explore the museum, to work within education, but within other divisions as well within the St. Louis Art Museum, but then the subsequent years of seeing Renee, having her as a mentor, having her as a colleague, and now as a really great friend, has been so influential.
Thank you for sharing, Sherri. And now that we've kind of had this chance to introduce ourselves, I have some questions for everyone to reflect on. In your experiences, what are some of the ways educators are uniquely poised to advocate for museum diversity, equity, and inclusion? Anyone can get us started.
I'll start. I think in a lot of ways, education and museum education departments have been on the forefront of this work and have really taken the giant leaps to get the museums involved in DEAI work. And so it's something that we have considered, at least in my experience, it has been critical and foundational to education work, the idea that we want to welcome and educate and help people learn and build the tools as many people and as different populations as possible. And so I see us as actually having the ability to be that foundation and then to teach other people within our institutions and to be advocates for other populations in diverse communities. I also think it's critical, though, while you have that foundation within education, that the institution values education enough to elevate those perspectives so that they sit in positions of influence and can have a voice. And hopefully from that voice, they can then build a culture where what we're doing in education becomes standard for the entire institution as a whole.
And I'll jump in and build on what Sherri was saying, that, you know, educators are used to marrying an understanding of history and context with making space for people's own experiences when we talk about art. And so when we approach diversity, equity, and inclusion in terms of the internal conversations that museums are having right now, grappling with history, grappling with people's biases and positionalities, we, as part of our practice, we're used to getting people to reflect on them in different ways that can reach people in different ways. So there's this possibility of getting people to grow, of building bridges across difference that I think we're really poised well to do. And as I'm reflecting on this question, I think if I'm honest, I would also say that I think we could do better as a field. I think that we could be better about sharing stories about the impact of our work, both internally and externally through publishing. What in my experience I have often done is that I speak about my own experience. I talk about the Bearden Fellowship. I talk about the Getty Marrow internship in Los Angeles and these opportunities that are so important for giving people of color a voice in the field and a start. But that shouldn't be the only kind of story we tell, because that keeps the burden on people of color to make those changes and to testify. And so I think that this is something that across the field of museum education needs to be seen as a shared responsibility. And then that can radiate out to the way that museums work as a whole.
Yeah, I want to echo that as well of, you know, both of what my colleagues have already mentioned about educators really being on the front line, pushing for this development in this work and asking critical questions. But also I see this as an individual pursuit, right? And so I see not only educators, but I see us before we walk into these institutions that were traditionally founded on not so inclusive or equitable foundations. Just for example, the St. Louis Art Museum that was founded in 1879, that's a long time. So we're dealing with roots, we're dealing with histories that have not been included, that have been disregarded, that has been siloed. And so as educators, as individuals, we should be walking into these institutions as really engaged citizens and conscious of not only the environment, the history in which we're walking into, the institutional grounding that we're walking into, but we have to do the work independently of ourselves, become transformative individuals, and so we can then transform institutional spaces. And so that's in the midst of where I'm thinking and how I want to empower my other colleagues outside of education, within other practices, within other departments, that it's really about individual work, right? And because I want the way how we do diversity, equity, inclusion to be transmittable outside of the museum field, that is able to intersect how we deal with cultural organizations and other cultural institutions, how we deal with academic institutions. We have, for myself, I'm on in an academic museum, but my approach is the same as I would like it to be if I was at St. Louis Art Museum, to be integrative. And so I want other colleagues to see that work and to model that work as well.
Likewise, I agree with my colleagues. Yes, educators are uniquely positioned to advocate for diversity, equity, and inclusion because, at least in my experience, educational programming is community-centered by nature and openly collaborative. Partnerships with schools, community organizations, artists, and even activists are often a result of shared goals and commitments to community engagement and reaching diverse audiences. Partnerships also connect you to communities you rarely have an opportunity to engage with. For example, in my experience, partnerships with Title I schools or organizations like Girls Inc. or Urban League have been able to yield some very fruitful results.
Yeah, thank you everyone for sharing your responses. And I think as Nenette was bringing up, a lot of institutions are grappling right now with what to do in terms of historical accountability. At the same time, a lot of institutions have been closed. What have the challenges and silver linings been to digital programming in the educational space?
I can jump in, although I'm maybe not the best because I work for a museum that is not yet open. So we've had the luxury of only stepping into virtual programming when the timing seemed right. Early on during the pandemic in April 2020, when we were working remotely from home, we were thinking about what our communities needed, particularly in South Los Angeles, where the museum is currently being built. And we ended up commissioning 12 local artists and artisans to sew masks for 7 organizations in Los Angeles that were serving vulnerable populations. And this was a time when PPE were very short and only being used for frontline medical staff. And we were really thinking about the artists who were out of work and also the lifelong seamstresses who had worked for Hollywood Productions. And thanks to their work and to that of 5 staff volunteers, we distributed 1,600 masks to the clients and staff of family clinics and elder care facilities and services for the unhoused. But all of this was taking place behind the scenes. So it was not a virtual program per se. So what we did as the kind of public face was that we held 3 online conversations or sewing circles that brought together a variety of creative practitioners like fashion designers, seamstresses, performance artists, textile artists. And we all talked about the role of sewing in their lives and in sharing stories. And so for me, this was, you know, a series of programs, but it was not a broad initiative. It was an example of our museum trying to be responsive to a moment, trying to put to center the needs of our communities as we understood them, and facilitate connections in our communities without centering the museum collection. You know, it was a chance to rethink why a museum programs and how, rather than just trying to make claim space in a crowded virtual sphere just to do it.
I'll jump in and say one of the great benefits of the virtual space has been expanded access, or the potential for expanded access, where it's not required that you come to the National Gallery of Art, in my case, that you can be in your kitchen in California and taking part in a program hosted by the National Gallery of Art. It's also, I think, this last year has democratized programming within the institution. So it's not just educators producing educational programs. I don't think the public makes a distinction between an education program and a program that comes out of our curatorial department. That does present a challenge when you do have these different divisions all trying to do their thing and trying to find that right balance of not just doing something because you can do it and you have a Zoom account, but doing something because it makes sense in this time and with the resources that you have, and you're not inundating your audience. But I do like the fact that access has grown exponentially. I see that in programming, live virtual programming, but I'm also seeing that in the internship program that is offered by the National Gallery of Art, which is 100% virtual. And now you see people applying for it who wouldn't be able to move to DC in the pre-COVID years.
Okay, I can go next. So technology, some of the challenges for me have not just been unique to this period. Some of the main challenges that I've encountered throughout the course of my career have been, one, using technology efficiently and effectively, and two, being able to adapt to new technologies as conditions change over time. Like, for example, at one point, now, it was deemed effective and efficient to use cell phone tours. Remember those days? Or the audio wands that were always available when you would walk into a museum. And then in later years, you would find it that it was more effective to actually use options like SoundCloud or maybe publish a podcast that you could deliver to, say, the smartphone generation. Now, in terms of silver linings, technology has proven to be effective, you know, as my colleagues have mentioned, at increasing audience engagement by making content accessible to broader audiences. Now, for example, YouTube essentially provides the means for storing videos online, removing the need to have a dedicated server space or something like that, or organizing your content by playlists, et cetera. Now, and the videos can easily be shared on social media or embedded in web pages, including websites that are responsive, where you can have the same experience whether you're on a mobile phone or a desktop computer. And of course, you know, the obvious way, as my colleague mentioned, is with programs like this, where you can use live video recordings to engage a wider audience that would otherwise be limited to a physical space with limited seating.
Yeah, for me and my museum, this extension of outreach has been great. Just to provide a little bit of framework or insight, Waterville, where we are based, is a town of only 16,000 residents. And so average on our, depending on the program, pre-COVID, our museum capacity was about maybe 35 within galleries. For our small intimate talks that we would have. And then for larger conversations and lectures, our max audience that we can host is about 300, depending on our, if we're using museum facilities or the college facilities. And so annually, with the programming that we would have in-house, with our K through 12 audience, about 4,000 in a year, and our larger public-facing programs that would bring about 5,000 folks throughout the year. Under 10,000 we would see annually. However, with moving our programs digitally and online, we're able to reach twice of that number. And so just with 1 year offering digital programs, we have seen on our YouTube and our Facebook page over 20,000 viewership, which has doubled. We would have not been able to host that number in-house because just the size and the capacity of what we have. And so that has allowed us to really extend what we offer our community. We have been able to really show the richness of our collection and the artworks that we interpret and that we teach from. And one program in particular is our Let Art Inspire program, which is the museum's wellness program. And so that program has taken off. I think the pandemic in itself was a testament of folks just wanting to have something that is fulfilling to them, right? And it's that is not so overly academic, right? But something that is very low hanging fruit that they can incorporate within their every life. And so we offer three programs through that larger program. We look at an artwork from our collection through a monthly theme. We look at that artwork through the lens of yoga, meditation, and healing, which is a creative hands-on experience. And through that, for example, just to give you a past program that we did in this virtual realm, we used the theme Time to Ground Yourself. And so that theme was inspired by a local Wabanaki artist, Teresa Secord. And we looked at her piece, Penobscot Barrel. And for our yoga program, which is entitled Artful Movements, we looked at the raised hand yoga pose, which is also known as the palm tree yoga pose as well. And so combining this experience within itself was really rewarding for us. We're looking at art and providing necessary steps and other entry points for folks to come to us and access our collection. The challenges for that was that our community, we were closed to our wider audiences. So we were only able to be open to our testing and on-campus community, but our wider audience in our community who has been great patrons for us really missed us. And as we do them. And so just thinking about ways to engage them was really on the forefront of us. And so we created a digital platform for keeping with our local community in mind, but also our extended outreach where folks can really be integrated with every aspects of our upcoming exhibitions, our current exhibitions, the programming that are associated with them. And so we looked really intensively outward to what other museums were doing, how they were advertising their exhibitions and their programs and incorporating it into a style that was uniquely for us and fit the needs for our audience as well. So those have been the challenges and positive, more positives for us being a smaller institution in a smaller neighborhood versus, you know, my colleagues that are really at some powerhouse institutions within themselves.
I really echo what you say, Jordia, in reaching more audiences. I think during my time as a fellow, I'm doing very similar projects to what you completed, but completely virtually. So the brochure that every fellow makes each year has now gone online. And even such a thing as a small gallery talk, maybe 10, 15 people might come, but now you're having audiences around 50 attending a gallery talk that a Bearden Fellow is able to give. So I think in a way, the virtual programs not only expand the reach of the museum, but also of the Bearden Fellowship itself and the profile of the fellow while they're here at the museum. And I've also had the chance to meet all of you through Zoom as well. I think that wouldn't have happened if not for this digital space. And to that, Jordia, can you tell us about your new position and what some of the goals are around diversity and inclusion?
Sure. So currently I'm at Colby College, but this summer I will be joining the staff at Indigo Arts Alliance, which is based in Portland, Maine, so south of where I am currently. And I'll be joining the team as the inaugural deputy director. And so a little bit about Indigo is that it is embrace a multiracial approach to the rich intersections of citizenship, community building, and creativity through the means of offering art residences to BIPOC artists, along with strengthening community understanding of Black and Brown Indigenous experiences to the betterment of society. We're also is a component of strengthening public engagement through the means of the artist residency, because they see artists playing a unique role in strengthening our multiracial democracy. And so we need artists for their vision and inspiration to help build a more humane, inclusive, and just world. And so as a deputy director coming into this position, my focus will really be enhancing the residency experience, but also the public integration through the means of programming. So I'm looking to also contribute to the larger diaspora in the canon and the information that adds to all of our unique experiences and adding to the diversity of voices. But I'm also looking forward to establishing, strengthening, and providing different roadmaps, to cultural understanding, cultural wellness, community growth, and buy-in. So we all are able to kind of exist and live in a world that values all lives and all voices.
Congratulations on that position, Jordia. I look forward to seeing the great work that you'll do there. On another note, I see that Tim has Romare Bearden in his background. I really appreciate that. And though the fellowship is named for Black artists, and there's no pressure to exclusively study Black art or focus on Black artists. But to Tim, what museum experiences involving the contributions of Black artists have left a lasting impression on you?
Yeah, that was a challenging question to answer because there's so many of them. But here, I'll try to be concise as possible. The Doc Thrass exhibition in 2001-2002 left a lasting impression on me because it shaped my entry into the museum field. I have the graduate school. I was hired as a temporary museum teacher for the Phillips Museum of Art to lead tours through the Doc Thrash exhibition. And it was exciting because Doc Thrash was virtually unknown at the time, and yet he was an artist who contributed vitally to the printmaking field through his invention of copper rundle mezzotint, or what we used to say back then was the microwave mezzotint. Subsequently, the exhibition traveled to the St. Louis Art Museum the following year while I was a Romare Bearden Fellow. So I was able to extend my experience by assisting the Prints, Drawings, and Photographs Department and Philip Roger, who was the curator at the time. As Associate Curator of Education at the Hunter Museum of American Art, and this is between, I guess, 2005-2007, I was fortunate to partner with the Urban League to develop a program that addressed identity and race relations. And the concept for the program was developed in accordance with Carrie Mae Weems' exhibition titled The Louisiana Project, which was basically Weems' response to the bicentennial of the Louisiana Purchase, including, you know, its underpinning of secrecy and sexual liaisons, you know, across racial lines. What I remember most, though, are the responses from the students from the Urban League regarding Weems' use of silhouettes, which simultaneously kind of revealed and concealed their meaning. And as director of education, I organized events and programs for the Taft Museum's Duncanson Arts and Resident Program, which celebrated contributions by contemporary Black artists in honor of Robert S. Duncanson, who painted the murals in the museum's foyer. One experience in particular, though, involved my collaboration with artist Carla Cook, a Grammy-nominated jazz vocalist. The most obvious reason, I think, for my excitement, though, stems from my own passionate interest in jazz history, but more importantly, having a unique and rare opportunity to work with such a prestigious artist. Carla Cook performed in, say, my annual fall jazz series, which I had every year. She performed with high school students during a family program. She led participatory performances at 8 elementary school workshops, with music students at local colleges and universities, and performed live at local churches and premier jazz clubs. And there are lots of other experiences too that I won't go into great detail with, but, you know, one working with an artist named Winfred Rimbert, who was an artist who paints personal narratives on leather. And actually there's a feature documentary about his life called All Me. And an artist named Yvonne Wells, who was a quilt artist out of Tuscaloosa, Alabama. So really quite a number of rich experiences in that regard.
Thank you, Tim. And you'd be happy to hear it. I'm actually working on a Doc Thrash virtual experience soon. We're doing a brief gallery talk on the works. And that's another thing, the prints, you can't see them on the walls all the time, but with virtual, we can definitely really share his amazing work and his particular printmaking process at the time too. So thank you for sharing that. And I think earlier, Nenette, you mentioned that you're working at a museum that isn't quite open yet and the difficulties of that. Can you give a brief description of your museum, what it's like to work at a museum that's not opened yet, and some of the challenges associated with that?
So this, for those of you who haven't had a chance to visit our website yet, here's a couple of renderings of the project. This is a museum, the Lucas Museum of Narrative Art. It's currently under construction in Exposition Park in Los Angeles, joining a thriving community of museums and arts organizations there. We're a museum dedicated to the art of visual storytelling, including book illustrations, comic arts, magazines, murals, paintings, drawings, photography, as well as the arts of filmmaking. If you could just, continue to cycle through these images, you'll see that the architecture, which is designed by Ma Yansong, is incredibly striking. But for me, it's inside that is really exciting, as we're going to have 9 learning studios for educational programs for people of all ages. There's going to be a beautiful publicly accessible library reading room that we're calling the Stacks. And you can see these kind of just otherworldly spaces, and but that it also includes 6.5 acres of landscaped gardens by the landscape architect Mia Lair. And Jordia mentioned wellness programs. And, for me, this garden is going to be such an opportunity to highlight the physical and emotional benefits to wellness of the arts and of museums, as well as their intellectual and creative benefits to wellness. Working at a museum that is as many of my colleagues have described, it's like working at a startup, where it's very different from working at an institution that is 125 years old, as most of my career has been spent in, because possibility can be a little overwhelming. But what's been really wonderful is that I'm working with an incredibly talented team of individuals who come from a variety of backgrounds, not just museums. So we're learning from one another from outside of the field, as well as taking what we know about the history of museums, the challenges of museums, and trying to solve for those issues so that we can do it at the front end and not necessarily in real time. I feel really glad that I'm at the table for certain kinds of decisions, things that I took for granted, like what's this sign going to say and where is it going to be placed? What kind of audiovisual capabilities are we going to have in our learning spaces? Where are those plugs going to be located, and how many volts will they have? Will they support movies in the garden? And it requires this amazingly collaborative culture of people bringing their expertise to the table and stitching it together in order to solve for these complex issues. So I think, we also have the benefit of watching museums and their struggles right now. My team in learning and engagement has been deep into research. And we are watching all of you who are out there working in museums, who are on the ground, who are on the Zoom, in the public, and trying to imagine what things might look like in 2023. And so I think that what that's required is just a really nimble approach, a way of approaching the work that requires changing course as new information becomes available. And I've been really grateful to be able to learn from really inspirational leadership, like our director and CEO, Sandra Jackson Dumont. As we kind of chart a new way of being, and maybe even try to define a new role for museums in society. I think that for me, what's particularly exciting is that we have the opportunity to bridge the popular and academic fields of art. There are going to be so many people who come to our museum who aren't museum people, or who don't describe themselves as museum people, because they're coming to see and they have wonderful memories about Star Wars. And then we get to introduce them to Carrie Mae Weems and Romare Bearden and those kinds of epic stories. So I hope that all of you will come to visit when we open, and I look forward to showing you around.
Thank you for showing those amazing photographs. I can't wait to go visit. Do you know when you're set to open?
We don't have an official opening date yet, but we've said 2023. Fingers crossed.
Wonderful. And so our last question before we break into our Q&A for Sherri. How do we define and cultivate community in a digital space? I know we kind of started on this, but can you expand a bit more?
Sure. I don't actually have an answer. I have some beginning thoughts on it. It's actually something I've struggled with before the pandemic. And I think the idea of community has grown even murkier with the pandemic, where audience and community are kind of like merged together into a super beast. Everybody is a part of your community, I think, when you're virtual. But I do think that some of the things that are beneficial is when we think about community, is it something personal, a one-to-one between me and the museum, where I feel like I am a part of the museum community, versus I'm experiencing this with other people and we are all a community and we're all sharing in this, and maybe I can feel like we appreciate this in the same way. So some of the things that I've seen done, not by me personally, but for the institution as a whole, has been creating experiences that allow for communication, that allow for small group discussion, that allow for reflection, that allow for people to hear each other, see each other, and come together around a common topic or a common point that gives space for people to have discussions and to find points of commonality, but also to drill down into points of difference. I've also seen things that are much more directed communication on our part. So they seem much more relevant to the people who are receiving them. That shows that the institution is really thinking carefully and critically about our messaging and what we're putting out there, because we recognize that people are being inundated right now with all kinds of things in a virtual space, and that we want to be a place that offers support to you, that you can come and find respite. That's where I am right now, but if we have time, I'm not sure if we do, I'd love to hear from the other panelists their thoughts on this subject as well.
We have some time for answers for this, absolutely. And it is an ongoing discussion. It's something, you know, you're thinking about with an event like this. You have a webinar format, but you have a smaller group format. What have you all experienced, or are there other questions that you have that you're still milling over how to expand this community space?
I think that this period is open to a lot of possibilities. And I think it's worth paying attention to the kind of technologies that are available to us that can make things happen. Like, one of the things that I really like right now, but what seems to be most effective from an internal organizational standpoint, is the concept behind Microsoft Teams. When I think of that concept, Teams, I think of that as being basically a network of people, and it could be any group of people, not just people who are internal to your organization, but people who are external to your organization. All those traditional concepts that we had about an advisory committee or a student advisory committee or what have you, it sort of takes those basic concepts that were sort of germane to the actual physical space of meeting with people and expanding that to a concept like Microsoft Teams. I think has incredible potential in terms of the cross-fertilization that can come out of that. The fact that any given member can be a part of 10 teams, 20 teams, 30 teams, and realizing that the potential for that kind of exchange, I think, is pretty remarkable. And I'm willing to, I expect that Microsoft is probably going to capitalize on the success that they've had so far. Obviously, they're trying to go into schools now too. But I have a feeling that that concept is going to become much more prevalent in the community engagement space as well, and not just something that is internal to the organization.
I think that's a super interesting point, Tim. And, you know, let's hope that that's the potential of this moment bears that fruit. And I also think it points up the need for educators to increase their own technical literacy. Like, many people had to do that on the fly in the moment. They're editing videos, they're figuring out the capabilities of Zoom. And, you know, there's something to be said for that. And because educators are the most flexible and nimble folks that I know. But to be able to maybe invest a little bit more in acquiring those skills and that knowledge. And then also that may change the way we hire, you know, for future education teams, because one of the things that we're really thinking about is how to create a maybe a little bit more porous or integrated flow between the virtual and the in-person, knowing that your audience and your community may contract or shrink or grow on any given platform. And so to think a little bit more fluidly in those terms, though, we need to kind of know the capabilities of the technology a little bit better.
Yes. Anything quick to add, Jordia, before we go into the Q&A?
I think my colleagues hit everything. I would also echo that, you know, what Lynette is saying in regards to staffing and institutional spending and budget in technology, that I could see there being new positions being created in order to sustain this work, right? I don't think digital programming is going anywhere. Like, even though we are planning to reopen our doors, hopefully in the near future, but we'll see, we're having these conversations of what programs will be hybrid, what programs will be just offered online or just in the digital spheres, what programs will we take off digital and bring back of just in person. And because of that work and understanding the labor that comes with doing digital programming, right, is another set of careful consideration, careful planning, and other details that have to be incorporated. It takes knowing that labor. I can see, you know, extra staffing and support being delegated to assist this work, so we can be able to satisfy all of these multitude of audiences or community. Sherri was alerting to, right? Because when we're in person, we know exactly who our target audience are. We know exactly how to evaluate that program and to grow that program. But when we offer it out to the world and it's accessible for all, it's hard to gauge impact. It's hard besides the count, besides the views, right? How do we tailor those programs to fit a large community needs when we're not having that consistent one-on-one engagement with them? And so I think that's adding another level, of like how to evaluate and really think about moving forward with programs that are intimate for our immediate community and then outward as well.
Thank you for sharing the feedback. I think this is a conversation we'll continue to have. I have our first question from the Q&A. It's quite an interesting question, but I hope you guys enjoy it. So to any fellow, if you were to start or open a new museum, what theme would it be, or how would it reflect the Black experience and aesthetic?
I'm gonna say probably something around contemporary African art, but I've never been asked this question before, so that just like popped into my head. So that's what I'm going with, contemporary African art, and hopefully something that can draw on kind of the interconnectedness of people on the continent of Africa, but also throughout the diaspora.
I'm going to jump in with say, this is also another question I've never been asked before as well. So this completely threw me for a loop. So thank you to the one who posed it. But for me, because my focus is so community-based, it would definitely be a museum of people, right? And so I really want to be able to incorporate the importance of archiving community experiences and community voices and seeing the academic value that they provide, right? Everyone has cultural knowledge that needs to be archived that is connected to the visual arts, the performance arts. And so to find the intersections of them and to interwove them into something more collaborative, right? I also want to empower communities as well. So museums also have another barrier that communities don't see themselves in them, right? Communities have a hard time to access them. And so to create an institution or to create an organization that is community focused, community-based, community-centered, but not so much strongly on the archiving of artifacts, but the archiving of communities' contributions will be where I'm going.
Great. Another question. In what ways has the fellowship grown or changed since you each completed it? We're running on the end of the session. So I was wondering actually, Nenette, if you could take this one as a fellow that was one of the earlier fellows in the 30 years that we've had here at the museum. And then maybe we can have Jordia reflect as well. She was a fellow a few years before me.
I think that Renee and Stephanie in their earlier session talked a little bit about the evolution, but I know that during my time, I was in the transitional time between when the fellowship was more housed squarely in the education department and then before it moved over under Renee's direction. So I think that is a major shift from my own experience. But, you know, and I'm a little bit jealous of the fellows who got to work so closely with Renee. I also had some great experiences working with so closely with the educators. I have taken this fellowship, the Bearden Fellowship experience with me throughout my career, and I constantly reference it. I talked about it all the time when I was at the Art Institute of Chicago as they were building their diversifying art museum leadership initiatives. I talk about it in my current position because it was such an opportunity for me to see myself as a professional in this field. And I think for me, you know, in an earlier video, Brent Benjamin was talking about the trajectory of the fellow to the colleague. And I think what was special is that I felt like a colleague as a fellow. And so that kind of respect that the fellows are able to carry with it because of that position and the ways that the museum has consistently invested in this fellowship and made it a part of their identity, I think is so wonderful, and showing that their ability to listen to previous fellows' experience and evolve the fellowship so that it meets the needs of now versus when the fellowship first existed, and it is a great example for other institutions in the field.
Yeah, to add to that, the biggest change is the length of time. From day one, when I started my fellowship, Sherri said, this year is going to go by fast. Walking in, you think a year being such a long time that you're able to hit all of your kind of points or goals that you set for yourself within the fellowship, but it really does quickly pass. And I was the 21st fellow, and so there was a good amount of understanding of the workload and the projects that were already kind of established prior to walking into your fellowship. And so completing those tasks, you look back and you already have completed 6 months, right? And you're staring at the last end of your 6 months. And so we would speak to Renee consistently about this has to be longer, right? And the importance of mentorship was also so strong that we wanted to be able to be mentored, but also to give back, right? And to have a crossover or a lap over with the onboarding fellow. I only got like a few days to really give my kind of insight into the fellowship to Courtney, who was coming on after me. And so now I think, you know, this is where the fellowship is going, is to really center fellowship knowledge and transfer of knowledge, and to build a more of a networking and an understanding of community, right? I spoke about it at the very beginning, this establishment of these communities within communities that are really here to see you not survive, but to really thrive, right? And to become leaders in the field. And so that I see that as where the fellowship is growing. Integrating more of us within the everyday aspects of the museum, and also having voice to leadership levels as well, to really shaping and turning, and as the world is adapting, so is the fellowship.
Thank you, Jordia. Unfortunately, we have to wrap up today's first session, but you can join us for the second session that will begin shortly about charting one's own path. Thank you to all of our panelists that have spoken today. You can see all their bios on our website. Thank you, everyone.